When talking TV sex therapy, it is one name that springs to mind.
There is nothing more interesting in this entire world than what people do at home, in a certain room.
Dr. Ruth Westheimer. Famous around the world, Dr. Ruth is the little lady with the no-nonsense approach to sex.
However, when I'm with a woman, I can't seem to even get excited.
You don't seem to be able to get an erection?
Ruth's strong advocacy for the use of contraception and her support of legalized abortion and AIDS awareness have put her firmly in the public consciousness. But this is the least remarkable thing about her. Because Dr. Ruth Westheimer has had many lives. A refugee of Hitler's Holocaust after the murder of her Jewish parents. An ardent Zionist. And a sniper for the underground Jewish army. From globe-trotting academic and teacher to wife and mother, this is the story of one woman's extraordinary capacity for reinvention and survival. Dr. Ruth Westheimer is famous the world over. In the 1980s, she dominated the airwaves.
This museum was just opened, as if for me.
With her upfront, often explicit, but very likable persona.
How are we doing? I don't talk about politics, I talk about sex.
TV's number one sex therapist, Dr. Ruth was and remains a household name.
I recognize not only in a few days, I'm going to Jerusalem, yes, and I'm giving a masterclass on education and media.
But it's her Jewish roots that have shaped her extraordinary life.
Anytime I see shoes or a suitcase, it makes me cry because that could have been me.
She was born Carola Ruth Siegel on the 4th of June, 1928, in Weisenfeld, Germany, to Jewish parents. Her mother, Irma, had met her father, Julius, while serving as a domestic help in his family household in Frankfurt. Irma's pregnancy soon after saw them marry, and the three of them, together with Julius's mother, Selma, took a modest apartment in the north of Frankfurt.
My grandmother, who was a widow, my grandfather had died before I was born. She had nothing else to do but to take care of me. My father was kind of a merchant. He went to stores to sell merchandise. My mother helped him. They went by bicycle. It was a lower middle-class family.
Ruth was raised as an Orthodox Jew.
The Orthodox Jewish tradition, only boys went to synagogue on Friday evening with their fathers. Since I was an only child, I was permitted to go with my father. And I remember very well that my father had enough money to buy me an ice cream on the way to the synagogue. I had a superb, fantastic, happy childhood.
As Ruth was reaching her fifth birthday in 1933, Adolf Hitler became Chancellor of Germany. Hitler's loathing of the Jews would see Germany's Jewish community reduced to subhuman status. A series of anti-Semitic policies excluded Germany's 500,000 Jews from social and political life. By April that year, prominent Jews were forced out of government service and universities and barred from entering the professions.
I already knew that there are black clouds on the horizon. I did have a sense of anti-Semitism growing because my Jewish school was closed. We had a radio that already was illegal. The Nazi regime didn't permit Jews to have a radio.
In a move to starve Jewish businesses, in 1934, all Jewish shops were marked with the Yellow Star of David or had the word Juden written on the window. The Nuremberg Laws, passed in 1935, deprived Jews of virtually all civil rights. But on the 9th of November 1938, a wave of violence would change the life of Carola Ruth Ziegel forever. Hitler ordered a 7-day campaign of terror against the Jews in Germany. 10,000 shops owned by Jews were destroyed and their contents stolen. Homes and synagogues were set on fire and left to burn. Kristallnacht, or the Night of Broken Glass, left 100 Jews dead and more than 25,000 of Germany's Jewish men removed to detention camps.
I do remember that people on the way to the synagogue told my father, "You have nothing to worry. The ones they wanted to take, the ones the Nazis wanted to take, they took already."
But within 24 hours, Julius was taken to the labor camp, Buchenwald.
Very early in the morning, a man came into the apartment. They didn't hit anybody. They didn't shout. I just remember the leather boots. And I do remember my grandmother. She took out money, gave it to these Nazis, and said, "Take good care of my son." I then went to the window. I saw my father getting on a truck. I saw him turning. I can see that in my mind's eye. I saw him trying to smile and waving.
On the 5th of January, 1939, a bewildered 10-year-old Ruth found herself at the railway station in Frankfurt, awaiting transportation. But she was one of the lucky ones. She had been selected to join a small group for kinder transport, the evacuation of Jewish children to other European countries, including Britain, Belgium, France, and Switzerland.
My mother and grandmother came running. I remember my grandmother running, and at the time she wasn't young. To say goodbye to me at the train station. And they said that don't be sad. We are going to see each other again. Trust in God. And they hugged me, and I could wave and see them waving until it made the bend where I couldn't see them anymore.
Ruth's mother and grandmother had told her that if she went to Switzerland, her father would be released from his detention camp and allowed home. She was also tempted by the promise of lots of chocolate and the assurance that they'd come and get her soon.
I, as a mother and a grandmother, I don't know if I could have done that sacrifice to put my only child or my any of my two children on a train to safety, not knowing if we would ever see each other.
Ruth's destination was Heiden, a picturesque village close to Lake Constance. She was taken to a children's home for Swiss Jews.
They were children from the age of 6, the youngest, and 14, and I was 10 and a half. For me, going with the other children was very important. It gave us psychological strength to be in that terrible situation.
Despite her young age, Ruth worked hard. She recorded a typical day in her diary.
At 6:15, Hannelore comes to wake us up. We go to the washrooms and help to comb the children's hair. After I've had my coffee, I get a pail of water from the kitchen and a broom and sweep the floors. Then I clean the toilets. When all this is done, I mop the floor with a wet mop. In the evening, I help bathe the children, and after dinner, I clean their shoes. I like all my chores very much. They wanted to prove to the Swiss authorities and to the people in the village that Jews are not dirty. The house was spotless. Every Friday, we had to scrub the floor. We had to wash the laundry. I was made responsible for a group of children. And since I wanted to be a pediatrician, I said, okay, I'll be a kindergarten teacher.
In keeping with the Jewish Orthodox tradition, it was the boys whose schooling was encouraged. But Ruth closely adhered to another Jewish philosophy.
I was always driven. Part of this has to do with the Jewish culture of learning, of the importance in trusting in God and of learning. My father said, study. Study hard, because the underlying philosophy of that was that nobody can take that away from you.
When Britain declared war on Germany in September 1939, Europe became a battlefield. And for millions of people, it was a fight for survival. But for those Jews unable to find sanctuary in countries like America and Britain, the war would be particularly cruel. While Ruth was at Heiden, her father had been released and returned home. And for a couple of years, she received frequent correspondence from her parents. But by the end of 1941, that changed.
November 12, 1941. I still don't have any news from my dear sweet parents and grandma. November 25. It is almost 7 weeks that I don't have mail for my parents and grandma. December 17th. On the first night of Hanukkah, I was so terribly homesick. December 18th. Today, it is 9 weeks and 1 day that I have no mail for my parents.
In late 1941, Ruth's parents had been transported to the ghetto in Łódź, Poland. In 1941 and 1942, almost 40,000 Jews across Europe were deported to Łódź. Already filled with 160,000 Jews, a third of the city's population, the ghetto had no running water or sewer system. Hard labor, overcrowding, and starvation saw 40,000 people die there. Those who managed to survive the conditions were eventually deported to Nazi extermination camps. By August 1944, all surviving residents of the ghetto had been removed to Auschwitz-Birkenau. In Switzerland, Ruth and the other children were becoming aware of the horrors taking place outside of their safe haven.
The first thing I knew, that children came from Bergen-Belsen, which was a concentration camp. I do remember their suitcases with smelling underpants. You see how interesting what a child remembers? They told us stories that I couldn't believe that there is such a thing. So slowly and slowly, after the Bergen-Belsen children arrived, we heard stories.
Ruth would never find out exactly what happened to her parents. But either in Łódź ghetto or in Auschwitz, Julius and Irma became two of the Holocaust's victims. After having not heard from them for nearly 5 years, Ruth's diary suggested that she had lost all hope.
I would so much like to relive the days with my parents. I did not know what my parents mean to me. But now, and especially today, I do realize it so well. I would so very much like to make up to them for all they did for me, all that I never appreciated.
In total, Ruth was in Switzerland for more than 6 years, celebrating her 11th birthday through to her 17th birthday there. In that time, she'd experienced a lot and grown up a lot. Like any teenager, she was filled with nagging self-doubt. A diary extract reads,
I'm ugly, I'm stupid. What will become of me? Who am I? What right do I have to be alive? What is my purpose in life?
Another read,
one has to keep struggling, but alone, always alone. I do miss my parents terribly. No friend can take their place. Oh, how I long for them. How homesick I am. Now I have to go back and make a fresh start.
The war in Europe finally came to an end in 1945. And people discovered the extent of the Nazi atrocities against the Jews.
I passed through the barrier and found myself in the world of a nightmare. The living lay with their heads against the corpses, and around them moved the awful, ghostly procession of emaciated, aimless people with nothing to do and no hope of life.
For Ruth, to go back to Germany was unthinkable. Instead, she became fascinated with Zionism. The goal of the modern Zionist movement was the creation and settlement of a permanent Jewish homeland.
The decision to go to Palestine, there was no question. First of all, who would take the Jews? Switzerland didn't want them. Any other country didn't really appeal to me. I said, we Jews need a country of our own.
Ruth was so convinced by Zionism that she turned down the opportunity to study teaching in Switzerland. On the 7th of May, Ruth wrote,
what does it mean to be a Jew? I realize it more and more. We must have our own country. Even if not all Jews can live there, they will have a nationality, a state that will protect them, they will no longer be so helpless. We need strong new generations. We demand Jewish honor. I have promised to remain faithful to my people, my language, and my culture. And I will keep this promise, come what may.
Ruth left Switzerland in July 1945 and traveled by ship to Israel. After 6 days at sea, she arrived in Haifa. But if she thought she had arrived in a Jewish paradise, she was wrong. Palestine was under British control. Back in 1917, the British had agreed to the establishment of a national Jewish homeland there. Already struggling to control the largely unhappy Arab population, British forces had now controversially implemented a strict entry policy for tens of thousands of Jewish refugees fleeing Europe.
The British even thought we had permission. I had a certificate. They put us in a camp with barbed wire. I only stayed there 1 week, so it's not a hardship, but it was difficult for us because here we came from an orphanage. And why do they put us in barbed wire? We were not illegal immigrants.
Advised to drop her first name, Carola, as it sounded too German, she adopted her middle name, Ruth. Together with friends, Ruth decided to join a kibbutz. Kibbutzim are collective farms in which members receive no salaries, but necessities such as housing, food, clothing, and medical care in return for their labor. The collective philosophy became an integral part of the Zionist ideal. Ruth's kibbutz was called Ayanot and was close to Haifa, producing fruit, including olives, oranges, apples, and grapes. Ayanot was home to 300 people of varying ages. Like at Haydn, Ruth, now 17, worked hard.
I wanted to work with the children. I wanted to be a kindergarten teacher. There was a prettier girl than me. She got that job. And I got a job, it was terrible. I was assigned to the kitchen, to the toilets, to cleaning, until I finally could work with the children.
But as a teenager, Ruth still lacked confidence. In her diary, she wrote,
I would like to describe the beauty and the truth of life here in the land of Israel. But I'm not happy. Is it still the inferiority complex? How can I be a kindergarten teacher? I know nothing of art or literature. How can I give a man something? How can I build a life? Because I'm going to bore him to death.
Ruth had already experienced the stirrings of an interest in boys at Haydn. But it was on the kibbutz that she first really discovered sex.
I slept in a tent and in a makeshift kind of house for almost a year with three guys, but I didn't sleep with them. However, there was a good-looking fellow. He was in the British Brigade in Egypt. He was gorgeous in that uniform. And I went with him to a barn on a kibbutz, quietly, quietly. And that was when I lost my virginity. And strangely, thank God, I didn't get pregnant. I didn't know about contraceptives then.
Within a couple of years, Ruth had started to lose faith in the kibbutzim movement.
I would not have been able to predict this idealistic, socialist kind of living together, working the earth, that this would not work. I had lived now from the age of 10 and a half. I realized I don't want a collective life anymore. I need to have a life of my own.
Instead, she threw herself into self-improvement. In the autumn of 1946, Ruth took a kitchen job in return for free studies at a kindergarten seminary. And hungry as ever to expand her knowledge, she learned Hebrew and took classes in maths and French. She also learned about the methods of innovative educational practitioners like Montessori, Froebel, and Pestalozzi. Ruth still possessed the burning idealism that had first brought her to Palestine. But by 1947, the political situation was spiraling out of control. Jews and Arabs had been given their own territories, but they were finding it impossible to coexist. On the 29th of November, 1947, a plan was set in motion whereby the British would leave Palestine and the country would be divided into a Jewish state and an Arab state. But the announcement sparked a three-way war between the Jews and the Arabs, who both wanted their own state and the end of British rule, and the British, who were still trying to keep the peace. Against the advice of her friends, Ruth did an extraordinary thing.
My joining the Haganah, the underground, the forerunner of the Israel Defense Forces, was not an act of heroism. All of us joined some kind of group in order to fight for that country, Palestine.
The Haganah was a Jewish underground army. It schooled Ruth in the use of explosives and machine guns.
I don't know how I got to be trained as a sniper. Maybe I had some facility of aiming, but I was very happy to do that. I was also happy, today, looking back, I never had to kill anybody. But I don't know where I got the aim of being a sniper. So anybody who works with me, watch out. I can still put 5 bullets into the red circle and throw hand grenades.
On the 14th of May, 1948, the British left the country. David Ben-Gurion proclaimed independence of the State of Israel before the Provisional State Council in Tel Aviv.
I heard Ben-Gurion's speech. I was in the street. None of us went to sleep. I was on a truck that went through Jerusalem, stopped different places, danced, and the whole night. I even remember listening on the radio to the votes coming in at the, from the United Nations. But I also was a little naive. I thought there will never be war again.
But on the same day, the armies of Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, Egypt, and Iraq invaded Israel as fighting erupted all over the country.
When the fighting started of 7 Arab armies, I didn't realize it really. I did not realize that we were so surrounded, except in Jerusalem. I do remember the Jordanian soldiers standing with their guns aiming at the Jewish quarter.
Then, on the 4th of June, 1948, on her 20th birthday, Ruth returned home after her surveillance duties.
I was in a girl's residence and the siren sounded. I knew what it meant, go to the shelter. But somebody had given me a book for my birthday. And I said, I'll go to the room first, I'll pick up my book, then I'll go to the shelter. As I came down into the hallway, a bomb came into that room, killed some girls next to me, and a shrapnel from the cannonball went through both my legs. I do remember the girl that I asked who opened my shoes, do I have to die?
The worst damage was to Ruth's feet, with the top of one foot entirely blown away. She would endure a lengthy convalescence in hospital alongside other soldiers. In January 1949, a final armistice agreement was reached. The war came to an end. Israel not only won the war, it increased its territory by a half. But there would be no rejoicing in the streets this time. Too many people had died, with virtually every family having lost someone. After finishing her studies, Ruth embarked on her first proper job, teaching kindergarten to Yemenite refugee children. By now, she was deeply disillusioned with life in Israel. It was time to begin an entirely new phase of her life.
I was married at the age of 21. And the then husband, with whom I'm still friends, fortunately for me, he went to study in Paris, medicine. By the time I came to Paris, it was in 1951, I couldn't believe my eyes. First of all, in Israel at the time, there were very, very difficult times. There was not enough to eat. In Paris, I saw a whole cow outside a butcher's store. I almost vomited by seeing so much meat. I saw material for dresses. I went to the theater every night and on the cheapest seats, but I learned French fast. And Paris, as poor as we were very fortunate.
Ruth took a job as a director of a kindergarten for Jewish children, and also studied French history and psychology. An interest in clinical psychology would eventually lead her to one of Europe's greatest universities, the Sorbonne. She would stay on and continue her studies despite the amicable end to her marriage. But it was with another relationship that Ruth went to New York, and so began the American phase of her life.
I met a good-looking French guy, and he was divorced. And I said, I have enough money to buy you a suit and passage, fourth class, to come on a visit to America. We stayed up the whole night to watch the Statue of Liberty and to say hi to the Statue of Liberty.
Flicking through a Jewish newspaper, Ruth grasped her next opportunity. A New York university was offering a scholarship for victims of the Nazis. Within 24 hours, she had won a place on a master's degree course in sociology. She also took the equivalent of a BA and a master's degree in psychology. Ruth also discovered she was pregnant. she married her partner, Dan. Baby Miriam was born in 1957, but the marriage ended amicably when Miriam was just one. Ruth now faced the difficult task of raising a child as a single working mother in New York.
I knew there was a kindergarten, a nursery school, that would accept my daughter and for little money. I always can make friendships. So in my building, I had an arrangement with another woman who had two children. One day a week, she went to school, I took her two children. The other day in the week, I went to school, she took Miriam.
Shortly after, Ruth met Manfred Westheimer, who would become her soulmate. A German Jew, his family had escaped the Nazis in 1938. Fred had lived in America since 1941. The couple were married on the 10th of December, 1961. Within a couple of years, baby Joel was born. Ruth began working as a researcher at Columbia University and co-authored several articles for scholarly journals. Then, in 1967, Ruth's professional life took a significant turn.
I needed a job and I was offered a position at Planned Parenthood of New York City.
The project's aim was to educate low-income families in Harlem about birth control.
I took it. I thought there's something wrong with these people. All they do is talk about sex, not about literature, not about the weather, just about sex. 48 hours later, I said, hold it. That's a very interesting project.
Her work ignited an interest in family life and child rearing in different cultures. The Planned Parenthood Project also convinced her of the importance of contraception and of abortion, then illegal in America.
I don't want anybody to have an abortion, but I believe that abortion must be available. Otherwise, in the States, only women with money can get an abortion because they can fly to Europe or to Mexico. And others will resort to abortionists and to coat-hangers.
By 1970, the sexual revolution was in full swing. And sexual liberation brought with it a new fad.
This is a show about sex. Every week we get together here and we discuss some aspect of sexuality, what it means to be sexual.
Sexual self-help.
Well, now you know, we're going to talk about sex, so if you don't want to hear it, you should change the station.
Jim Jackson and his wife Leslie started treatment a year ago and are now described as almost cured. But it took 4 years of unhappiness to convince them that they really did have a problem.
If I've got a sexual problem, that means there's something so seriously wrong with me as a woman that to admit it to myself was difficult.
Ruth, now armed with a PhD in education, spotted an opportunity.
I knew enough how to teach sex education, but people asked me questions about premature ejaculation, about an inability to have orgasms, retarded ejaculation, all kind of questions I didn't have answers. I needed further training.
In 1976, Ruth retrained and became a certified psychosexual therapist and began training others to be sex therapists. She also opened her own office on East 73rd Street in New York. Still teaching therapy, an interesting proposition came her way.
A letter came, would one of us talk to a group of broadcasters about the need for sex education? There was no money attached to the letter. Nobody wanted to go. I said I go. I didn't think I would do the program.
In May 1980, Ruth was offered a 15-minute slot at midnight on a Sunday. It was the birth of Dr. Ruth.
This is Mike, and I'm calling from Wisconsin.
Hello, Mike from Wisconsin.
How are you doing tonight?
Very well.
Good, I'm doing okay.
What happened on the radio show? That I have to do it in my way, old-fashioned and a square, but explicit talk.
The problem I'm having is when I masturbate with books or things on that nature, I have no problem getting an erection.
About orgasm, about anything, that homosexuality, anything that comes up. And I think it was the first time that somebody spoke about it so openly.
When I'm with a woman, I can't seem to even get excited.
You don't seem to be able to get an erection?
A year later, Ruth published her first book, Dr. Ruth's Guide to Good Sex. Sexually Speaking expanded to a two-hour show and was picked up by more than 90 stations across America. Ruth went from being an unknown college professor to a national celebrity as her radio fame transferred to the small screen.
This program includes explicit sexual references and may not be suitable for all viewers.
I did 450 television shows. I used actors and actresses on my television shows, a Lifetime cable television. We assigned them a problem. He comes home, he finds his wife in bed with his best friend. And I talk to the two of them.
Hello, you are on the air.
Hi, Dr. Ruth, around 2 weeks ago, a woman had called in about having sex with her husband and another female.
Yes.
Okay, well, I just wanted to let you know that you were right. My husband does want more. And I told him to fantasize about the event because that's what I thought you would tell me to do.
Right. And it worked?
Yes.
Terrific. You know what I mean?
I'm taking a comfortable grandmotherly approach because I was already 50 when I started the radio and then the television. It made people feel at ease.
Throughout the mid-1980s, Ruth's profile grew. More TV shows and more books were punctuated with regular chat show appearances around the globe.
Other people might just from time to time read something in order to be sexually literate. She's going to say, go away with your big erection. I can say, maybe you have a concern. Maybe not a serious problem, but maybe a concern.
Ruth was also asked to endorse an array of products, from condoms and chocolate mousse to Dr. Pepper soda and shower gel.
If you think that's great, try the body wash.
By 1987, Ruth moved from cable to broadcast television with her show, Ask Dr. Ruth. But away from the world of celebrity TV, in the mid-80s, sex therapy faced a serious issue, AIDS. America lagged behind much of the Western world in its handling of the disease. By the time the first coordinated AIDS education campaign was launched in 1988, nearly 83,000 cases of AIDS had been identified in America, and over 45,000 people had died.
I think I was of tremendous importance because I keep on talking. I don't mind if I sound like a broken record. In the beginning, I did not know what AIDS was. As soon as I was taught by physicians, I said, you can't have unprotected sexual activity.
Ruth has continued to help raise awareness and support AIDS charities. Today, Ruth no longer has her own show, but she continues to publish, on average, a book a year.
Great.
Perfect.
Good.
And her Dr. Ruth website allows her to maintain a regular dialogue with her 21st century audience.
I don't have secrets, but I do talk about sex, and it's a fun book, especially for Valentine's Day.
Now in her 80s, Ruth is wealthy, successful, and remains a famous name around the world. But central to her life are her Jewish roots. Having fled Nazi Germany back in 1939, Ruth reunites each year with her fellow kinder transportees from Haydn. And for some years has given a talk at the annual Holocaust Remembrance at a veterans hospital in New York. In 1997, Fred Westheimer passed away. Now, both children and their families are regular visitors to her home in Washington Heights in Manhattan, where Ruth has lived for 50 years.
What I value in terms of family, in terms of friendships, in terms of life in general, have remained the same. I do believe that we have to work at it. It doesn't just come down from the sky. At relationships you have to work at, and at sexual relationships you have to work at.
Ruth continues to travel the world, lecturing and giving talks focused on sex education and sex psychotherapy. She has also branched out, making serious documentaries following other cultures and traditions. But it is Ruth's own experiences that remain her motivation.
The most important thing that shaped me is the background from home, the religious and the cultural background, and then comes that obligation to have to make a dent in the world. I think the red thread that goes throughout my whole life is to be an educator. This says in Hebrew, Da lifnei mi ata omed, know before whom you stand.
Ruth Carola Westheimer's exceptional life, from orphan of the Holocaust and freedom fighter to sex therapist, media sensation, and mother, is credit to her unwavering courage and fortitude.
My legacy should be that I am very grateful to be alive, but that I also tried to make out of that happening the best by being able to help to make this world better, because I was saved and was not killed like the millions of other Jewish children.